Welcome everyone to the penultimate episode of Additive 101 presented by Siemens. This is episode 4 where we're going to cover production printing as well as metal printing. So there's a lot to talk about. Let's have a quick look at the course syllabus and then we'll get started. So today in episode 4, we're going to follow up our prototyping and plastics discussion from episode 3 with a discussion of production printing and metal printing. We'll talk about when you should think about using additive for production. We'll talk about how metal printing came about. We'll talk about how some of the various different metal printing technologies work, and we'll discuss some good use cases for metal 3D printing. So last episode, we talked about the tight connection between 3D printing and prototyping. So that sort of begs the question, when is additive applicable to production manufacturing? Well, there are a lot of things to think about when looking at additive as a production technology. So one thing we really should consider here is part complexity. Now, I'll talk a little bit more about this in a bit. But in general, the more complex a part is, the more it might benefit from additive manufacturing. Also, it's worth noting that the relationship might not be a straight curve like I show here, but we can say that in general, this relationship between complexity and AM applicability does hold. So another thing to consider is the lot size of what you're producing. So if you're manufacturing 50 to maybe 1,000 parts, then additive might be an attractive option. But if you're manufacturing 50,000 parts, then it will probably be more economical to use a legacy production method in a majority of cases. Different technologies, of course, have different curves here, as some technologies can print more parts in a single job than others. And of course, over time, we'd expect this curve to flatten a bit. But in general, you know, additive is great for smaller lot sizes, but the applicability kind of decreases as the lot sizes go up. So cost is another factor to consider. However, I do think that cost is something that will continue to improve over time. Now, at the current time, for many production applications, the cost of additive is prohibitive when you compare it with other legacy manufacturing methods. However, the cost of printing is dropping rapidly, whereas the cost of manufacturing with most legacy methods has already mostly depreciated. So there's a good probability that at some point, depending on other factors that we're sort of discussing here, you're going to hit that inflection point for your particular situation, and the cost factors will be met. So it's a bit of a mixed bag here. We've seen some use cases hit this inflection point much faster than we thought they would, and some have taken a little bit longer to come around than we expected. But in general, the cost of additive is dropping rapidly. So this continually opens up new use cases that might have been cost prohibitive in the past. So now that you have some tips about when it might be good to consider additive for production, let's talk a little bit about metal printing. So metal printing has a shorter history than plastic printing, but its use has increased significantly, and especially when we're talking about production part manufacturing. So we can see some of the highlights in the history of metal printing in this timeline. Now, metal printing came on the scene early in the 1990s, although of course there was some research done before that. But between 95 and 2005, new metal printing technologies rapidly entered the market. And we're going to talk about several of those here today. So in that timeline, you saw a couple of different metal printing technologies listed. So let's have a look at a few of those in some more detail here. As with plastic printing in episode 3, I'm not going to cover all of the various technologies here. Of course, just like with plastics, there are variations on the different themes here, and of course, people are coming up with new technologies all the time. So I'm just going to hit on a few of the more common technologies that are in use today. So we talked about selective laser melting in episode 3, and we talked about the various different plastic printing technologies. Now, that same technology can be used to print metal parts. Now, as you'd expect, there are some details, minor details that are different. So, for example, the build chamber used to print metal parts is usually airtight, where the air is evacuated. They introduce some sort of inert gas to ensure smooth welding. But the process is basically the same. Now, there's also a similar technology called electron beam melting or e-beam. In this case, the fusion method is an electron beam rather than a laser. But again, the basic process is essentially the same or very similar. So, just like we saw in episode 3, here's a basic diagram of the powder bed process. So, the beam of energy is focused on a specific spot in the bed of powder. This raises the temperature of the powder enough in that spot so that the powder particles fuse with other powder particles around it and with the previous layer. Now, these printers can print multiple parts in a single batch. However, parts printed in metal powder bed printers do require support structures, as the density of the fused part is too heavy to be supported by the loose powder, like what we see happening in a plastic powder bed system. So, also similar to plastic printing, binder jetting can be used to print metal parts. Now, in this case, jetting uses metal powder as the base material, but instead of fusing it with a laser, a liquid binder is squirted in very small droplets into the powder by a print head that moves back and forth across the bed of powder. Now, with binder jetting, the liquid is an adhesive which binds the particles of plastic together. Now, the main difference between how this works with plastics versus metals is that metal parts require a heat treatment post-process to center the metal part into a solid part. This post-process heat treatment also causes a certain amount of shrinkage, which must be compensated for either during the design or print preparation phase. So, while the basic process is the same, it becomes much more complex for metals due to this necessary heat treatment step. Note, however, that binder jetting, whether in plastic or in metal, does not require support structures. So, this is one advantage to this particular technology. Now, directed energy deposition is similar to powder bed fusion in that it usually uses a metal powder and a focused energy source. However, in this case, there is no bed of powder. Rather, the powder is fed into the path of an energy source. Now, in this diagram, we see the beam of energy is focused on a specific spot, and the powder is blown into the path of the energy beam. And as with powder bed technologies, this raises the temperature of the powder enough that the powder particles fuse with the other powder particles around them and the layer beneath them. So the advantages here are less powder usage than with the powder bed system, the ability to print relatively large parts, and also the ability to print parts in multiple axes as opposed to each layer being planar. Now, it's also worth noting that there's an alternate version of this technology where the material supplied is in a filament form. So, similar to the fused filament fabrication technology we talked about in episode 3. In this case, the material would be a spool of metal wire, and the wire is melted by the energy source just like the powder is. So, same idea as the blown powder, but a different source material format. So, we've looked at production printing and some of the various metal printing technologies, and now it's time to look at a few of the good use cases for metal printing. So, we talked a little about part consolidation back in episode 2, when we talked about additive use cases in general, and at that time I gave a part consolidation example that involved a polymer part. However, in reality, we see a lot more part consolidation coming with metal printing. This is mostly because a lot of complex machinery is made out of metal parts. And as we talked about in episode 2, anytime you have complexity, you have the potential for part consolidation. Now, we've done this ourselves at Siemens, where our power generation division created a fuel burner that was printed as a single part, where before the burner was manufactured from something like 13 individual parts. Now, many of these parts came from different suppliers. There was a lot of manual labor required to assemble those parts into a final burner. And of course, this took a lot of time. So by consolidating those parts into a single printed part, Siemens was able to reduce the lead time for burners from 26 weeks down to only 3 weeks. And we also reduced the weight of the burner by 22% in the same process. So also in episode 2, we talked a little bit about optimization. Now, we see this especially in industries like aerospace, where weight is an important consideration. So for example, let's consider the design of satellites. Every pound of material that you launch into space costs $10,000. So therefore, you can imagine that saving a pound here and a pound there really adds up to enormous cost benefits. Applications like these are why optimization of part geometry is so attractive, and additive makes these kinds of parts attainable because it's uniquely positioned to manufacture the organic, free-flowing geometries that often result from an optimization operation. So, for example, the part towards the bottom here would be extremely hard to machine because there are very few regular surfaces on it. Shaping a part like this would take many more operations than, for example, shaping the cast part that's above it. This would probably rise the cost of the part beyond what's realistic for machining. So one final application to consider for metal printing is thermal management. Now, when you're talking about heat transfer, in many cases, the more surface area you have, the better the heat transfer. So this is a case where those lattice structures that we talked about in episode 2 can really come in handy, because you can create lattice structures with much larger surface area than you can machine or create using other legacy techniques. In fact, we're starting to see custom automotive manifolds in the racing industry that include external lattice structures specifically to aid in heat dissipation. So any application where thermal transfer is a consideration might be a really good application to consider metal additive manufacturing. Well, there you have it. We are 4 episodes down with 1 to go. We hope you'll join us for episode 5, where we will wrap up the series by taking some of these things we've talked about in episodes 1 through 4 and taking them several layers deeper. So until then, from all of us here at Siemens, thanks for joining us.